ashes, you will take your place. Oh, 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 here comes a comeback. This is your time, your moment. The fire, the fight, you're golden. You've come so far, keep going. Oh, here comes a comeback. Another heartbreak day, feels like you're miles away. Don't even need no shade when your sun don't shine. Too many passengers roll by like limousines. It's hard to keep believing when they pass you by. I know your heart been broke again. I know your prayers ain't been answered yet. I know you're feeling like you got nothing left. Well, lift your head. It ain't over yet, it ain't over yet. So keep walking, soldier, keep moving on. Keep walking until the morning comes. Keep walking, soldier. I never will forget, I never will forget. So hold on, hold on, we'll already finish it. Hold on, hold on. So get up and move.
Yeah. Are you guys ready to worship tonight? So come on, why don't you stand with us? And hey, listen, if you like to worship at the altar, come on now. This is the time to do it. And come on, let's pray and then get right into this. Come on, pray with me. Father, we thank you tonight that you're going to release your grace and your favor and your glory over this place. God, we thank you for your presence, and we thank you during worship that you're going to set people free. Father, we just pray a release of freedom in the house tonight. Come on, freedom for miracles, freedom for miracles, freedom for miracles. Come on, let's worship.
We come to lift you up.
In-ear things in that makes me not be able to hear, so you're gonna have to shout louder than that. Are you ready to worship Jesus tonight, to lift him up? Come on.
We come to lift you up. Because you're great.
Let's just raise our hands tonight.
Singing glory in the high. We bring glory to your name. You are God. Not because we praise you. Not because we love you. But because you are. Not because we praise you, not because we love you, but because you are. You are God. Not because we praise you, not because we love you. Because you are. Ooh. Oh, we give you your place, oh God. More than just our feelings. We give you the place you deserve. Oh, and thrown every part of our lives. You are God, not because we praise you, not because we love you, but because you are. From everlasting to everlasting. From everlasting to everlasting. From everlasting to everlasting. From everlasting to everlasting.
Come on, let's worship King of Kings.
Everlasting. Sing it. singing glory in the God who was and is to come. You will always be, will always be.
Come on, this evening we're lifting him up above every circumstance, above every situation, above anything that we might see with our natural eyes, above any impossibility. Come on, we're putting our eyes on Jesus. He's bigger. He's greater. Oh, 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 you can trust him. You can trust him.
That's right, that's the reason we're here, to lift you above everything, everything. I see Jesus, I see him bigger, I see him greater. I see him wilder. Whoa, hey, I see his authority. Whoa, I see that every knee must bow. I see that every tongue confess. Thank you.
Come on, if you got your heavenly language, just begin to release it. What chain can remain in the presence of God? What bondage can remain in the presence of my Lord? Ooh. Is there any chain too strong? Is there any lock that he cannot open? Oh, we worship you. We worship about the next song. Hey, you're the melody of heaven, and sing that one.
make everything shine. There's no situation, there's no circumstance that you can't turn around and make it shiny. Lord, you're brilliant. Lord, you're brilliant. Brilliant colors coming into your life. Colors that have never been found coming into your life. Colors being released, yeah, right here in this place. Oh, new rainbows, new rainbows. Taking your black and white, and giving it color. Taking your ordinary and making it super ordinary. Taking your everyday, taking your everyday and making it unusually awesome. Taking your 9-to-5 and making it powerful. Hey.
Sing it out.
And now I'm more of you. I want more. Yeah. And now I'm more of you. I gotta have more. Hey, I want more. 'cause I want more of you. Call me greedy, but I want more of you. I want more. I want more of you. I want more.
I'll stop it. Deeper together.
Oh, everything I have, I want more of you. Oh, everything I have, I want
everything.
Everything I have, I want more of you. Everything I have, I'm in love with you. Everything I have. of everything I had, and I'm in love with you. I'll abandon anything for everything I had. I'm in love. I'm in love with you. Hey, oh, everything I had. I'm in. I wanna dance with you, I wanna dance with you, I wanna dance with you, wanna dance with you, I wanna move with you, I wanna move with you, I wanna move. Glory in the highest. Hallelujah. Woo! Is there anyone greater? Is there anyone who loves you more? Is there anyone who would give his son? Who would give his son? Who would give his son? How great is your love? 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 Sweeter than anything I felt. Sweeter than anything I've seen. Sweeter than anything. Just enjoy his presence this morning.
Jesus.
Let's declare it.
Sweeter than anything I felt. Sweeter than anything I felt.
Yeah, yeah,
we're
yeah.
Singing. Sweeter than anything I see. Touch. Sweeter than anything I touch. Sweeter than anything.
God's going to set prisoners and captives free tonight. Prisoners are those who've been in bondage because of the choices that they made. Captives are those who have just been captured. God wants to set both of you free tonight. Not only in this room, but also in the houses that you're watching right now online, in your living room, in your bedroom, wherever you are, whether it's in your phone, I'm telling you, God is going to set you free. Tonight's a night of freedom for some of you. Yeah, so Father, we pray right now. Prison by fear, prison by shame, prison by lies, all those things, all those chains that are going to be broken off, are broken off tonight. So, Father, I just release the power of your presence, the power of the name of Jesus, the power of the name of Jesus, because there's no other name, no other name, there's no other name that has power. Only the name of Jesus. Only the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we overcome. In the name of Jesus, every chain will be broken up. In the name of Jesus, every person is set free. Every prisoner is free. Every captive is free. In the name of Jesus tonight, right now, right now, right now, in this place, tonight is a night of deliverance.
Tonight is a night of salvation. Tonight is a night of hope. Tonight is a night of faith. Thank you, God. Thank you. We release that over this region right now. Thank you, Father, over this region. We release the name of Jesus over this region. This region, we establish your name, God. We establish who you are. Establish who you are. Jesus. 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 Thank you, Father.
Anything, anything, anything. Anything and everything. All things. On heaven and earth. All things. Nothing hidden. Nothing hidden in him. But it belongs to him. We belong to him. Amen? Yeah, you and I belong to him. What else do you want? That is enough that we belong to him. That's all matters. That's all matters. Amen? Come on. So let's give a shout of praise to Jesus. Shout it out. Yeah. Well, find someone and give them a big hug. Tell them you belong to the King.
bless you? He already has, hasn't he? Well, let me tell you, we are glad that y'all are here tonight. And we're glad that all y'all are here tonight, too. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, even on a Tuesday night. Come on. You guys come to church on a Tuesday night. This is prime time. And we're in the house of God. There's no place more prime than the house of God. Amen? All right. I have the privilege of receiving tonight's offering. And just one thing I want to say real quick the Lord put on my heart. And that is this scripture. It says, in this is love, not, say that with me, not that we love God. Not that we love God, but that He loves us. Come on, can you get excited about that? And He gave His Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Wow. And then it goes on a little later and it says, we love because. We love because. Say that. I love because. Do you know the because? Do you know the because? Because He first loved me. He loves me. You need to get a, if you need to get a daisy and just, He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. Every petal, He loves me. Come on. You are loved. You need to tell yourself, I am loved. You need to own it. Amen? I am loved. I'm His favorite. You're His favorite. I don't know how He does it. I just know I'm His favorite. Amen. So we want to receive an offering tonight. And you know, there is no other motivation really to give except that we're in love. Amen. Love is the motivation. And besides that, we love to bless the men of God that come into this house to minister. And you get an opportunity to sow into that tonight. So we ask you to be led of the Lord and give your best. Amen. Because you're loved. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you for what you're doing in this house. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives. We thank you for this season in the earth. Oh, we can only imagine what lies ahead. And Father, we bless you. We thank you. We thank you for this offering tonight. Bless it, Lord, both gift and giver, to your purposes. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have a video.
That was good. I thought I was going to have to start dancing and singing up here, which the anointing would have left Micah right out the door just like that. Hey, Chuck, go ahead. You can turn that down just for a minute. I'm going to make an announcement. Most of you might have received one of these when you came in. If not, make sure you get one before you leave. This is our info on our next Blaze, which is happening in April. And we have Richard Gordon and a team of 60 students from Bethel School of Ministry. So listen, I just want to warn you, the last time Richard was here, he only had 10 students with him, and we barely kept the roof on. And so it's going to be 60 students, and so we're not sure what's going to happen. I'm sure the whole place is going to blow up, and they're going to rebuild it, blow it up again, rebuild it, blow it up again. It's going to be awesome. I won't actually be here. I'm going down with a team of people to Mexico, and we're doing a pastor's conference. And so make sure you're praying for our team as we're doing that. We're super pumped and excited to go down to Mexico and just instruct the leaders. Before we introduce Stephen, Mike is in the house. Micah, give me a high five. Micah and Stephen are amazing. We've had them for years now. They've come to the church and to the prayer school. But Stephen was preaching last night, and he said several things that were very profound. And my favorite one was he said, Pastor Jesse is going to be back. And he said, by the way, Jesse, it was good to see you. You have to fill out a visitor's card because you've been gone so long. He was literally in India. He flew back, and then he flew back across America to deal with some issues, and then flew back to Vancouver and drove here just today. And Stephen said about you that you are such a nice guy that if anyone doesn't like Jesse, they're probably just big jerks. And I thought that's deep theology right there, brother. That's very good. And we're excited to have Jesu and the India team back. They just did some amazing ministries, just street evangelism. And Pastor Kendall was talking about how many, like 260 one-on-one salvations on the street, which is just amazing. So let's honor our India team and welcome them back officially. This is night three of our four nights of Blaze. We got one more night tomorrow, so make sure you're here. Invite some people. And if you're watching online, If you're in the region, come down. You can watch the replay later, but come down, be in the house. So I want you to give a big round of applause and honor to Stephen Bell as he comes again. Come on, we just love you, brother.
Yeah. Come on. How about we do this? Stay standing. Stay standing. You were too quick. Thank you so much for welcoming me. Now, let's welcome Jesus. Just give a big yay! Jesus! Jesus! We love you, Lord! We love you, Jesus! Come on, get louder. Come on! Jesus! Jesus! We honor you, Lord. We honor your presence here, Jesus. We thank you that you're here. God, we love you. We love you. We love you. We love your presence. Yeah, nothing better than you. There's nothing better than Jesus. Turn to your neighbor and say, you get Jesus. And there's nothing better. Okay, now put your hand on your neighbor. Put your hands on your neighbors. And just begin to say, Lord, get them. Get them. Just begin to pray over them. Pray outrageous prayers, dangerous prayers. God, wreck them tonight. Wreck them, Jesus. Wreck them, Jesus. Hey, oh. Fire, fire, fire. Fire. Just begin to ask the Lord. Burn in them, Jesus. Fire. Fire of God. Fire of God. Fire of God. Burn in this place. Fire of the Holy Spirit. Fire of the Holy Spirit. Come on, you're doing well. Keep it up. Fire of the Holy Spirit. Fire of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Fresh wind of God. Blow. Blow, we welcome you, Jesus. We welcome the host of heaven into this room. Angels of God, you're welcome in this place. Jesus, you're welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Wow, we welcome you. Come and be yourself. Come and have your way. Lord, we don't want a tame God. We don't want a God on a leash. We don't want a controllable God. We want the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Roar in this place. Roar in this place. Roar in this place, God. Roar in this place, God. Roar in this place. Fire of God. Fire of God. Hey. Hey. I don't want a tame God. I'm tired of a tame God. Come on. Jesus, we love you. I just feel like there's a roar that's coming up from deep within us tonight. There's a war cry that's being released tonight. Did you know that you have a war cry? And it comes from deep within, the Spirit of God. Sometimes he's a gentleman. Sometimes he wants to come with peace, but sometimes he wants to roar. Sometimes he wants to do battle. Sometimes he wants to release a war cry from deep within you. Listen, some of you have been allowing the enemy to do things in your life, and God's saying, listen, you need to get a war cry and say, enough is enough. How many of you know there's not one victim in this room? There's not one victim in this room. You're victorious because he's victorious. You've been grafted into the victory of Jesus Christ. Say that. Say, I've been grafted in to the victory of Jesus Christ. And I want you to say this with some oomph in your spirit. You ready? Say this. Say, I'm not a victim.
I'm not a victim.
I'm victorious in Jesus. Enough is
enough.
In my home,
in my
family,
in my neighborhood,
in my city,
in my
nation.
Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus.
Come on, just give a shout of praise.
Woo!
Wow.
Thank
you,
Jesus.
That wasn't in my notes.
You guys
can be seated
if you're able.
Wow.
Woo.
Yeah, we
just say
to the folks
that are
watching live,
whether
it's on Facebook
or whatever,
everybody just
extend
your hands. Where's
the camera?
We're
right here.
Boom.
Everybody
who's watching
live right now,
we just release
the presence
of God right
now
into living
rooms.
Wherever
you're at right
now, we just
say, come,
Holy Spirit,
invade
these homes.
Invade,
God. We just
pray right
now.
We just
release the
power
of God.
Everybody
watching live,
the power
of God right
now.
In Jesus'
name.
Jesus'
name.
Somebody
who's
watching live,
I just
had the strong
sense,
somebody has
cancer,
and
right now
we just
command
cancer to
bow
to the
name of Jesus.
We
command
cancer
out of
every cell
of your
body.
We
release
the
resurrection
power
of God.
Be
healed in
Jesus'
name.
Cancer
go
right
now.
Healing
flow.
Right
now we just
ask,
Holy Spirit,
invade
this
person's
body.
I feel
like it's a
woman,
and
that
you're
trusting
in God,
you're
believing
God,
but
right
now we
just
declare
breakthrough
in
Jesus'
name.
If
that's you,
I want to,
listen,
if you're
watching
live
and that's
you,
I want
you
to
let us
know
what
God
did.
Come
on.
Wow.
Jesus.
Woo.
Wow.
Just,
listen,
let's just
begin to
pray in tongues.
Just
begin to
pray in
tongues.
Kuria
baba.
Sheka
ta ta ta
na
kuria baba.
Sheka
ta ta ta
na kuria
baba.
If you
don't
have
a prayer
language,
if you don't
have
the
gift of
tongues
right
now,
we
just release
a fresh
baptism
of the Holy
Spirit
into
this room
right
now.
If you
have
not
received
that
gift
yet,
we just
release
baptism
of the
Holy Spirit
right
now
on fire.
But
just begin
to pray
in tongues.
Shika
ria
ba ba ba.
Kuria
ba ba ba
ba.
Shike
te tena
kura
ma.
Hey
riambatana
shika
ria
ba ba.
Kuria
ba ba
shika
tatana
ne.
Kuria
ba ba ba
ba shike
te
tena
na.
Kura
ba ba
ba ba ba
shike
te
tena
ne.
Hey
shaka
ria
ba ba ba.
Kuria
ba ba
ba ba
shike
te
tena
ne.
Oh
Jesus.
Jesus,
Shakaria
ba ba ba
ba ba,
King of
kings,
Lord
of lords,
Jesus.
Jesus
is king.
Shikaria
ba ba ba
ba, Kuria baba ba shike te te ne ne ne. Kuria baba ba kuria mbata ne 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 ne. Shakata ta na ne 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 ne. Kuria baba. We just declare that any strongholds in this room have to be broken right now in Jesus' name. You can't stay. You can't stay. We just declare right now broken freedom in this room. Freedom in this room. Depression lifting off of people right now. If that's you right now, just believe. You don't have to raise your hand. Just receive. Just put your hands out. If you've been struggling with any bit of depression, I literally see the Lord just breaking that chain and it lifting off of you right now, just in the presence of the Lord. There's a king in the room. There's a king in the room. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. Depression, you have to go. Go. Go in Jesus' name. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. We just release joy on you. If that's you, if you've been struggling with depression, we just release the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Just a fresh anointing, the oil of gladness. Hey, if that's you, just open your mouth and just laugh. Jesus. Listen, if you pray for healing by faith, then go ahead and laugh by faith. Come on. Some of you need to warm up your laughter anyway. It's been a while. Wow, Jesus is in a good mood. Woo. Can we? Wow. Wow, wow, wow. What's your name? Carly. Can I pray for you, Carly? You can just stay right there. Thank you, Jesus, for Carly. Yeah, I just felt, Carly, you stand out in the crowd. Jesus wants you to know that you stand out in the crowd. It's he's given you an amazing personality, but more than that, he's placed favor on you, his favor on you, and I just, 2018 is just a year. I just keep hearing increased favor with God and man. Doors are opening. Desires that are in your heart are coming to pass. They're opening up. And we just thank you, Jesus. But yeah, he's smiling over you and he's just saying, hey, you stand out in a room. You stand out in a room. You need to realize when you walk into a place, you shift the atmosphere whether you try to or not. It's just what the grace that you carry. Yeah, thank you, Jesus. Bam, dreams, Lord. Release dreams. Shika ria baba. Wow. Wow. Yep, it's getting hot, isn't it? The AC's on, but Jesus is here. The burning one. Turn to your neighbor and say, the burning one is in the house. The burning one is in the house. How many of you know we've been grafted into the burning one? I said that last night. You've been grafted into a consuming fire. That's who our God is. Listen, he's untamed. He's untamed. Listen, if your God is controllable, if your God is on a leash, then I question what God you're believing in. Come on. It's time. It's time for Jesus to be unleashed, to be just unveiled. And you know what? He wants to do it through his church. He wants to do it. Here's the thing that the Lord is doing. He's shifting our mindset. He's renewing our minds to where we stop going to church and we start being the church. Now, am I saying that we don't gather together? No, we need to gather together. That's not what I'm saying. We need community. We are a family. But the point that I'm making is you don't go to church. You are the church. So what does that mean? 24/7. There's no off switch. This is who we are. It's not just what we do. You are the church when you're at work. You are the church when you go to school. You are the church when you go to Walmart. You are the church when you go to Starbucks to get coffee or wherever you get coffee. We are the church. And I heard the Lord say this to me. He said, spectator churchianity is over. He spoke that to me. He means business. Spectator churchianity is over. The Lord is literally like, I'm done with that. Why? Because he's raising up an army. He's been raising up an army. And there's many Davids who have been out in the field and they've been worshiping when nobody's watching. They've been lovers of God when nobody's looking. This is the army that God is raising up. He is bringing people out from the hidden place and putting them on display. And I'm not just talking about on a stage. I'm talking about just wherever God has placed you and given you influence, he is bringing people out from the secret place and putting them on display. And God's saying, these are my lovers. This is my army. What is the army? It's an army of lovers of God who are burning in the secret place. See, this was the secret to David's life. Remember last night I said, Lord, who am I speaking to? And he reminded me to tell you again. Some of you may not have been here last night. Most of you probably were. But I said, Lord, who am I speaking to? And he said, you're speaking to giant slayers. You're speaking to a room full of giant slayers. What made David a giant slayer? It's because he learned how to love God and worship God and commune with God and hear from God when there was no revival meeting. There was no Blaze Northwest meeting. There was no prayer meeting. I'm not saying those things are bad. Those things are all good, and we need to go to those things. Corporate gatherings are good. But listen, what happens when you have a corporate gathering of people who have been living in the secret place and they come together as a bunch of flames that come together and this huge bonfire just explodes because a bunch of flames have gathered? David lived from the secret place. Listen, I want to just break something too. Listen, you know, some people preach it like, well, you live in the secret place for a season, and then God promotes you, and then you're done with the secret place. That is the most stupid thing I've ever heard in my life. You don't graduate from the secret place with God. You never graduate from that place. To David, the secret place with God was the pinnacle of the Christian life. It was the apex of his life. That was the climax. And you know what? So he comes out of the secret place, and in the secret, when nobody's watching, he begins to get personal victory. When nobody's watching, what does he do? The bear and the lion. Nobody saw that. This is David getting personal victory. Why? Because of his love for God and learning how to receive God's love for him, learning how to give that love back to him. And how many of you know when you receive God's love and you give that love back to him, it causes courage to rise up in your spirit? Where does courage come from? Where did Jesus get his courage? Not just because he was the Son of God. Jesus became a man, flesh and blood, just like you and I. He had weaknesses as a human. Where did he get his courage? Because he would go away to a secret place on a mountain where nobody was watching. Do you know that when he, this just blows me away, when he was getting ready to choose his disciples, his team, his leaders who would shape culture and turn the world upside down. You know what it says? Right before he chose them, he went to a mountain by himself. Nobody, like very, very early when it was still dark. And it says literally he prayed all night. Some theologians believe he prayed for 12 hours straight, 1 hour for each leader. And what's he doing? No, he wasn't begging God. God, please show me who to pick. No, he's listening. He's communing. He's listening to the Father, because prayer is more about a person than requests, and it's more about listening than speaking. He's communing with the Father, and the Father is giving him wisdom, and he comes down from that secret place, and he knows who his team is. He knows the leaders that the Father has chosen, and that's where courage came from for Jesus. He knew. Listen, the other place where courage came from, where he got courage, was the voice of the Father saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Jesus knew. Listen, I said this last night. He didn't get any of his value from any of the miracles or anything that he did. He didn't get value from walking on water. He didn't get value from raising the dead, healing the sick, casting out demons. He did those things because they were expressions of the Father's love. His value was completely in the Father, receiving the Father's love, receiving the Father's words over his life, communing with the Father, and that's where he got his courage. Something's stirring. Something is stirring from within, not out of heaven, but from within. There's something stirring. There's the Lion of the tribe of Judah is inviting us. It's an invitation tonight. Jesus is saying, "Will you come closer? Will you say yes to the secret place for the rest of your life? Whatever that looks like for you." Jesus is saying, "Will you come and burn with me? Will you come and burn with me?" The road to Emmaus, did our hearts not burn within us when we heard him speak to us? When Jesus speaks, it comes with fire. Every time you hear his voice, it comes with fire. Will you come and burn with me? Wow, David. There's an army of Davids. And it's harvest time. And guess what? It's not harvest so we can find value in how many people we've led to the Lord. It's harvest time because God is the pursuer of all of humanity. He's relentless in his love. He's relentless in his pursuit of all of humanity. And he's saying, "Will you come join me in my relentless pursuit?" Why? So that the Lamb of God can receive the reward of his suffering. Father God is 100% motivated by the sacrifice of his Son. It will not be in vain. I don't know what to do with what I'm feeling right now. I'm like, I just want to roar. Does anybody feel like roaring? Just, come on, just roar. Okay, I feel better. Oh, yeah. Wow. Just say, wow. Just wow. Sometimes that's all you can say. Wow. Jesus, you're amazing. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. You've been grafted into his victory. Do you know that when David, here's an amazing thing. When David comes out of hiding and takes on Goliath, it's because David wasn't motivated by his enemy. He was motivated by who his God is. See, he was more aware of the greatness of God than the greatness of Goliath. And he comes out of hiding. He's learned personal victory in the secret place. He's learned how to worship in the secret place. He's learned how to burn with God in the secret place. He's been in this place where God has opened his heart to David in the secret place. It's like, I know the heart of God. God has opened his heart to me, and he comes out of the secret place, and he comes onto the scene. God opens up a door for him. He takes on Goliath because he's more aware of the greatness of God. Just like Joshua and Caleb, when the other 10 spies are like, nope, we can't go in there. The giants are too big. And Joshua and Caleb are like, we are well able. We are well able because God is with us. See, they were more aware of the greatness of their God than the giants in the land. You can't be intimidated when you have a healthy fear of the Lord. When you are in awe of who God is, you cannot be intimidated by the enemy. You just can't. It's about time we have people in the church that says, no, we are well able. We are well able. Let's go. Let's go. And David comes on and he cuts the head off of Goliath. Now here's the amazing thing. As soon as David conquers Goliath, guess what all of Israel did? If you read it, they celebrate and they say, we won! I mean, they shout the victory. They didn't even lift a sword in the battle. What's that remind you of? What's that remind you of? Us and Jesus. See, Israel, David didn't just fight on Israel's behalf. He was Israel. All of Israel was in David. And when David won, all of Israel won. Even though they didn't lift a sword and didn't deserve it because they were cowards, especially their king at the time, Saul, poor guy. It's just simply because he got his eyes off of God. That's why he just got his eyes off of God. Wow. There's just fire in this room. There's fire in this room. And all of Israel is in David. David wins the battle, and Israel celebrates, we won. Guess what? We have somebody greater than David, who fought on our behalf, fought a battle that was impossible for you and I to win. All of humanity was in Christ when he overcame sin and death on the cross. And when Jesus said, it is finished, all of humanity at that point could have said, we won! Because all of humanity was in him. And now just waiting to be born again so that they understand we've already won. Because all of humanity was in Jesus, the victor, the triumphant one, the King of glory. And that's the gospel. Listen, the gospel is we've already won. Are you going to say yes to it? Are you going to say yes to this good news? Are you going to receive the good news? We've won. We won. He already did it. It's finished. Are you going to say yes to it? That's the gospel. Come on. You have been grafted into his victory. I don't care how you feel. I don't care if you feel victorious or not. You are victorious. Well, I don't feel victorious today. Oh, so your problems are bigger than Jesus? Your feelings are bigger than what God did? Listen, God was not content to just be with you. He was not content to just bless you from a distance. He paid the ultimate price to live inside you. And all you had to do is say yes. That's it. I believe, yes, Jesus died for my sins, rose from the grave. He is my Savior. Boom, God lives inside you. We got the good end of the deal. We really did. We won the jackpot and didn't even know it. It's like, God, what did I get out of this deal? God's like, you want to know what you got? You got my son. You got my son. And I want you to learn how to love him the way I love him. Listen, you want to walk, how many of you want to walk in freedom from sin? Then stop trying to walk in freedom from sin and start loving the Son of God the way the Father loves him. Whoa. And you'll burn. And there won't be place for sin. Why? Because you're loving the Son the way the Father loves him. Did you know that the Holy Spirit absolutely adores the Son? Everything that the Holy Spirit does, everything that he speaks, everything that every part of his being is to honor and glorify and cherish and adore and love the Son. And most people think that the Holy Spirit's primary job description is just to smack your hand when you do something bad. Do you know that his primary job description is to teach you to adore the Son the way he adores the Son? The Son is the prize, the beauty, the jewel of heaven. Everything is centered on the Son in heaven. So you might as well start now because that's what we're going to do for eternity. You might as well just really get in love with Jesus now. See, God right now, all of you know this, you've heard this, you guys have amazing people that come through here, prophets, very prophetic people, and I'm sure that you guys have heard what's coming, what is happening and what's coming. Right? So harvest has started and is only going to increase from here on out, right? That's not anything new to you guys. Listen, I'm not coming here. I have a word that nobody else has. Listen, I think, right? We've all heard this, right? Okay, we know this. Harvest is here. And harvest is going to continue to increase. Why? Because the Father's heart beats. I'm getting this. Micah, I'm going to need you to share this testimony. Whoa. Whew. The Father's heart beats every single person's name on this planet. What would happen if we weren't just motivated by harvest? And we were motivated by the Father's heart beating every single person's name. Ugh. See, that only happens in the secret place. That doesn't happen from getting riled up in a revival meeting. That happens when you get into a place where the Father opens his heart up to you. And then what happens? You can't help but go and shine Jesus to the world around you. Why? Because you've been touched by the heart of God. Micah, won't you come up and share that encounter that you had?
Come on. You know, it's easy to love humanity when you actually get his love, the love that he has for humanity. See, again, the thing that we heard in the beginning, we love because he first loved us. I don't have a capacity to love the people around me. I don't. I've tried and I've fallen on my face over and over again. So how do we walk in love? How do we carry his heart of love? Because it's about an individual. It's about people. People aren't, we projectify people. Projectify. You're my project. But that's a human being, that's a person, that's a son and a daughter of God. And about eight years ago, I had this radical encounter with Jesus that changed my life forever. It was a John 3:16 encounter. And it made that scripture come alive to me. I was raised in the church and I could quote it in frontwards and backwards and sideways in every single way I could. I could quote that scripture. But then when I had this encounter with Jesus, it came alive to me. And it was this one day we were praying. We would regularly pray in our sanctuary and just lap around. And we would just turn on music and just pray for our city, pray for our church, pray for God to just move in our city. And I remember this day I was sitting in the back and I was honestly frustrated. Stephen was with me and my friends and we were just radically encountering God. And for me that day, I was frustrated. I was angry. I was agitated. Do you guys ever feel agitated? Like you feel like, you know, I'm right here. I'm here, but God's calling me here. You know, you ever feel that way? Like, I'm here, but you're telling me to be here. And how do I get there? You know, pearls are formed through frustration. I'm just saying. Agitation, frustration. What if that very thing is actually producing something inside you? The very thing that he promised is produced through pressure. And I'm feeling that pressure. I'm in that place of groaning and growth pain. And I'm in the back and I said, God, like, I don't want to just pray. I want to look like you. I don't want to just pray and then leave this room and I'm exactly the same. And people just get more of Micah and not more of Jesus. And the world doesn't need Micah. The world needs Jesus. The world doesn't need you. The world needs him. And I'm like, God, I want to be conformed and transformed into the image and likeness of your son. I want to look more like you. And in this place of pressure and frustration, I laid out on the back, in the floor, in the back. I was right back, like as if by those doors. And as soon as my head hit the ground, suddenly I was caught up in this vision. And it was just in my mind's eye. It was in my imagination. I wasn't physically caught up. It was in my imagination. And as I laid there, I suddenly saw Jesus walking down the center of the aisleway. And he was this ripped, muscular man. I mean, he literally was a bodybuilder. His arms were like Arnold Schwarzenegger arms. I'm serious. I was like, who is this guy? This is not the Jesus I've seen or pictured. You know, but the thing is Jesus is a bodybuilder. He loves to build up his body. He hits the gym every day. Every single day, Jesus hits the gym and he pushes and he pumps and he's lifting and he's deadlifting. He's lifting weights because he loves to have his body strong. He doesn't tear down his body. He builds his body up. And in the place of this strong body, this built up body, he's walking down the aisleway and his eyes were burning with fire. It was like a blue flame coming out of his eyes, his piercing eyes. And as he's slowly making his way towards me, I'm starting to get a little nervous. I'm like, oh my gosh, what is he going to do? What's going to happen? And I knew that he was good, but he didn't feel safe. Sometimes he'll actually stretch
your understanding of him. You know, sometimes maybe you see, you only see a gardener and not a master. You know, like Mary, she sees a gardener. She doesn't see the resurrected master. And he wants to upgrade your perspective of who he is. And that's what he's doing tonight. So he's walking back, and I'm getting nervous, and he made his way all the way back to me, and he knelt down beside me. He took a knee, and he knelt down beside me. And he, with these huge muscular arms, he lifted up from the back of my neck. He grabbed me firmly, and he kissed me on the lips. And I was like, I don't know. Is this okay? Is it? At the time, this was 7-8 years ago. I'm like, is this theologically sound? I'm all reasoning and thinking through what is happening. What's going on? Well, Song of Solomon says he let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. And he kisses me on the lips, and suddenly he slowly brings me up with those muscular arms. I feel the weight of these muscles slowly and slowly up to his heart. And as my ear got closer and closer to his heart, I began to hear the heartbeat of Christ. Ba-boom, 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 just this rhythm like a drum. And as my ear slowly rested upon the chest of Jesus, like John the Beloved, suddenly I heard something. Whew, you know what I heard? Micah, 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 over and over again. It wouldn't stop. His heart was beating my name. It was beating my name over and over again, and it was so overwhelming. I felt like I had to leave. Like, I have to, this love is too, it's too great. But I felt him squeeze me even tighter. And he was like, you need to hear this. You have to hear this. And over again, Micah, 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 wave after wave of this love. And in that moment, John 3:16 came alive to me. It was no longer for God so loved the world. It was for God so loved Micah that he gave his only son. And if I would believe in him, I wouldn't perish, but I would have everlasting life. His love became real. It became alive to me. It changed my life. His heart has been beating my name since before the beginning of time, before he said, let there be light. Before he spoke, let there be light. My name was in his heart. He actually created the world as a container for me to live on. He thought of me for all of eternity, and he said, in 1990, Mike is going to be born, and I need a container for him to live on. And as I had this encounter, suddenly I thought, I was like, in the grand scheme of things, yes, I'm his favorite. Yes, I'm loved. But in the grand scheme of things, I'm just a little dot in the ocean of humanity. And I suddenly realized, as I was hearing his heart beat my name, I realized if his heart was beating my name, his heart was beating everybody's name. His heart is beating your name and your name and your name. He's beating every single person's name that has ever lived and ever will live. That has ever lived and ever will live. His heart beat Hitler's name. His heart beat Mother Teresa's name. His heart beats Hillary's name. His heart beats Trump's name. His heart beats Putin's name. His heart beats the homosexual's name. His heart beats every single person's name in all of humanity. It's burning, it's beating, even before they were created. It says that he formed us in our mother's womb. He was intimately a part of creating us. He actually chose and handpicked you to be alive. You have extreme purpose and destiny, and the purpose you have is to be adopted as a daughter and son of God. The cross is the great equalizer for all of humanity, for each and every one of us. He died for my sin, and he died for your sin. And not only did he die for it, he became it. He became our sin upon that cross. If he did it for me, he did it for the man out there. So no longer do you have eyes of outreach or eyes of just evangelism or projecting people. Now you have eyes of extreme value where you see that drug pusher differently. You see that prostitute differently. You see your colleague at work differently that kind of frustrates you. That person at the gas station, your in-laws, you see them all differently. Amen? This is the gospel. This is the gospel. This will empower you with grace to live it every day. Not as a performance, but as something just effortlessly flows out of you, because it doesn't say do witnessing, it says be witness. It's not something that he's making you to do, it's something that he's making you to be. Be a witness. Come on. Come on.
I want you to pray something. Just come over here. Before we move on, I just, the Lord wants to release something here with that. And I just want to invite you, if you want to hear God's heart beating your name more clearly, and you want to hear God's heart beating people's names out there in the world who don't know him yet, God, I want your heart for the world around me. I want your heart for my neighbor. I want your heart for the people I encounter every day. I want your heart. Mike is growling. Made me a little nervous there. I'm just joking. But you know, I want you to stand up if that's what you want. You want to hear God's heart beating your name, but you also want his heart, his beating heart, for the world around you. Listen, don't just stand up if you don't mean to step into this. Okay, remember what I said last night. Everything in the kingdom is what? By grace, through faith. By grace, through faith. What is the by grace? It's the free gift. God will give you his heart freely right now. It's not about whether you deserve it or not. He'll do it because his son paid for it. But the through faith is whose responsibility? Say it's my responsibility. What is the through faith? Okay, God gave me something. He's made available to me his heart. Now I'm going to step into it. I'm going to access it. I'm going to receive it. I'm going to experience it. And I'm going to step out and I'm going to learn to release it to the people around me. Okay, if that's what you want, I'm going to have Micah just pray that over you.
Come on. You know, in the Bible it says that his love is poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. By the Holy Spirit. He is so eager to reveal his heart for each and every one of us. He wants us to be ruined by his love. For God so loved that he gave. That's the whole reason that Jesus came. So right now I just want you to hold out your hands like you're going to receive something. It says we have not received a spirit of fear, but we've received a spirit of adoption, crying, Abba, Father, Papa, Daddy. A spirit of adoption. Holy Spirit, just come and blow in this place. Just say this with me. Say, thank you, Father, for your spirit. Right now. Come and fill me with your love. Open my ears to hear your heart. Open my eyes to see your heart. Just come, Holy Spirit, and baptize my friends in your love. Do what only you can do. Baptize my friends in your love. The fire of your love. The fire of your love. Yeah, turn it up, Holy Spirit. Turn it up. Increase your presence. Increase your presence. I see some of you locking eyes with the fiery eyes of Jesus. Locking eyes with the fiery eyes of Jesus. I remember this phrase my mom said once. The Holy Spirit spoke to my mom and God said this to her. He said, I'm going to burn the eyes of my people open by the fire of my love. Our eyes are open to the humanity around us through the fire of his love. And I see some of you right now literally locking eyes with his fiery eyes of love, locking eyes with the fiery eyes of Jesus. Locking eyes.
I just recently saw a vision of the bride. The Father allowed, how many of you know we're the bride? We're the bride of Christ. I just recently, he allowed me to see the bride. She was beautiful, amazing. And she turned to the side so that I could look into her eyes. And when I looked into the eyes of the bride, what do you think I saw? I saw Jesus in her eyes. You know why? Because she's been gazing, staring at the sun. And she's looking more and more like him. So I want you to turn to a person next to you and just begin to pray for the person next to you. Lord, burn their eyes open with the fire of your love. Impart your heart, God. Just begin to pray for the person next to you. Burn their eyes open, God. Fresh filling of the love of God through the Holy Spirit. The love of God poured out into their hearts through the Holy Spirit. To burn their eyes open. To gaze upon the face of Jesus. To where when somebody looks at your eyes, they see Jesus. Because you've been staring. You've been gazing. You're in love. Just say this. Say, Holy Spirit, I want to be in love with Jesus. Teach me. Teach me, Spirit of God, to gaze upon the face of Jesus until I'm changed. Yeah. It was like what Micah said. The world doesn't need me. The world needs him. But the world needs him inside of me. The world needs him inside of you. What is the world getting when they encounter you? Ask yourself that. What are they getting when they encounter me? What are they getting? Thank you, Jesus. Wow. You guys, there is just a realm of his glory in this room. Just a realm of his glory. Okay, go ahead and be seated. I want to just share a couple more things, and then we're going to go into some ministry time here. We already have been. Amen. Oh, my wife just texted me and said she's going to bed. I love you, Jenny Bell. Wish I could kiss my kiddos right now. Yeah, I do love my kiddos. It's hard to talk right now. There's a real, on it, just a thick glory of God's presence just resting in this room. And it's not because we're performing, jumping through hoops. You know what? He's here because we're doing what he's doing. We're agreeing with him. We're putting value on him, and we're putting value on what he's doing right now. It's just that simple. So we know that it's harvest time, okay? The church right now is in a time of awakening. The awakening has already started, and it's going to increase. God is awakening us to three specific things that he showed me. He's awakening us to the greatness of his Son. He's awakening us to the greatness of our identity in the Son. And he's awakening us to the greatness of our purpose and the reason for why we're on the planet for such a time as this. We are in a time of awakening. And that awakening is going to shift into reformation, where God is going to begin to shift things in the way, listen, the expression of the church is going to change in one generation. And what's going to happen in this reformation is it's going to spill out and touch every mountain, every realm, every sphere of society. Because, like I said, God is determined and relentless to see Jesus get the full reward of his suffering. He will do it. He will do it. The question is, are we going to get on board with what he's doing and join him? That's just the question. And the only thing that's required of you and I is, yes, Jesus. Yes, God. Yes, I'm yours. I belong to you. I don't belong to me anymore. I'm purchased with blood. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I live in this body, I live by, not some translations say I live by faith in the Son of God. Others say I live by the faith of the Son of God. Either way works for me. I like his faith, though. It's limitless. His faith is limitless. And so we just, but here's the thing. Here's what the Lord spoke to me, and this is what I wanted to, one of the things I wanted to release tonight is that God is saying it's just as important, if not more important, than knowing prophetically what's happening and what's coming is understanding what God is doing right now to prepare us for what's coming. See, this is where wisdom is coupled with prophetic insight. And right now, we need wisdom in the house of God. And the wisdom is this. This is what the Lord spoke to me. He said, I am bringing alignment to my church to prepare my people for what's to come. I'm bringing alignment. And some of this alignment is not going to be fun. It's not. Because the Lord is going to deal with compromise in his church. He's already started. 7 months ago, the Lord spoke to me last summer, and he said, son, I want you to give me 6 months. And I was like, have you ever had the Lord speak to you and you have no clue what he's talking about? Like, it's so just vague. You're like, what do you mean by that, Lord? You know, like, if you're me, I'm like, 6 months for what? You know? And he wouldn't tell me. Because he doesn't have to. You know why? Because his number one concern is that I trust him. So he doesn't have to tell me. And I don't have the right to demand it of him. Because he is the Lord of my life. I'm not the Lord of his life. Unfortunately, many people in the church don't have that mindset. And so he didn't tell me. And so then I said, okay, Lord, I'll give you 6 months. I don't know what that means. I don't know what you're going to do, but I'll give you 6 months. And I said, Lord, I trust you. I trust you with my heart. Well, what he began to do for 6 months is he began to do some heart surgery and deal with some stuff in my life. And bring alignment to some thinking that was bad thinking. And he was bringing alignment to little areas. I call them pet strongholds. We like to pet them. I just love my stronghold here. Just brings me comfort. Just, you know, oh, little stronghold here. Oh, tried to bite me. Oh, my goodness. Gosh, better feed it. We medicate ourselves. And the Lord began to deal with me. And listen, I'm telling you, he wasn't nice about it. I knew it was the fear of the Lord. And he began to come in and he said, what do you turn to when you're discouraged? What do you turn to when you're frustrated? What do you turn to? What are you medicating yourself with? See, all things are permissible, but not all things are beneficial. And it takes maturity to know, oh, that's permissible, but it's maybe not beneficial for my life. See, here's the problem, is that we've been so grace-focused in the church, where, remember what I said, it's by grace through faith. See, we've been, for so long, we've just been by grace, by grace, by grace, by grace, by grace, but we're not talking about through faith. So then we just kind of remove our responsibility from the equation to respond to God with a yes in our hearts. And then we have these pet strongholds by grace. Oh, it's just grace. God doesn't care if I have a pet stronghold. It's grace. No, he does care. And by grace, he's going to deal with it. And so I'm telling you, the Lord is bringing alignment to the church because he's preparing us for what is coming to the earth and what's going to increase in the earth. And listen, if we're going to have harvest, what are we bringing them into? Have we thought of that? What are we bringing these people into? See, one of the areas that God's bringing alignment is that the church is a family. It's not an organization. It's not an institution. It's not a Sunday morning service. It's a family. And God's been challenging me as a leader in the church, as an associate leader at Riversong Church, what are you bringing the harvest into, son? See, I want to bring the harvest into family. But are you going to adjust things as a leader so that church looks like family? And I know that Keith carries that heart, and I know the leadership here carries that heart. And I'll end with this, along those lines, is that back in the beginning, listen, this is God's heart from the beginning. Adam and Eve, God said, be fruitful and multiply. What's that? Family. Be fruitful and multiply and take dominion of all the earth. See, we've tried to take dominion of all the earth without family. You cannot have dominion without family. This is God's plan. This is his way. You cannot have dominion without family. And God is bringing alignment. He's dealing with his leaders. I'm one of them. You know, one of the things that God dealt with me on, he said, hey, whose ministry is it? That's my ministry, Lord. Whose church is it, son? That's my church. No, no. I'm the head of the church. See, he's bringing alignment where God is bringing alignment where Jesus is going to be the head of his church again. And I'm telling you, it's going to look different. It's going to look different. And I've gotten to this place where I said, Lord, it's not my ministry, it's yours. It's not my church, it's yours. Do you know that that's a greater responsibility as a leader in the house of God? That is a greater level of responsibility because I must care for what belongs to him. And that's not just ministry. If you're called to business, whose business is it? If you're called to art, creativity, media, whose is it? Who does it belong to? Who's the Lord? I said this a few months ago. The question of our day is not, do you believe in God? It is, who is the Lord of your life? That is the question of the day. So the Lord's bringing alignment. So I felt to bring something different. I could come in here and trumpet, and I could rile you up with harvest and awakening and reformation. You've heard it all. You know it's coming. But what's on my life is God is bringing alignment. He's bringing alignment. Why? Because he wants us to be in a place where we can join him in what he's doing and have the right heart in doing it with him. Come on, he cares about the heart. Let's stand to our feet. Micah, can you come on up here? You got some any words or anything? Let's do this first. Thanks, bro. Yeah, maybe the keys or something. Thank you, Jesus. Now, I want to just encourage you. I know that was a strong word. I think you guys can handle it. You've got Pastor Keith's preaching. I think you guys can handle the truth. He just comes across as a man to me, a man after my own heart, where it's like, I call it what it is. Is that right? Okay, you guys are okay then. But listen, he's good. He's good. That's why I'm so rooted in the goodness of God. That's why when he said, give me 6 months, I was able to say, okay, God, I trust you. Why? Because I know he's a good papa. And I know that everything he does in my life is because he loves me. Because he loves me. Because he loves me. And even when he disciplines us, it says it's because of his love for us. He would never do anything to harm you. He would never do anything to crush you, to tear you down. He only does things to build you up. Even if he has to remove things, strip things away, it's to build you up. It's because he loves you. And so I just want to encourage you just to start with this, and then we're going to just release some words of knowledge and prophetic insight into people. Also, it's 9 o'clock, so if you have kids, in the child care, that place over there where kids hang out. It's hard under the anointing to think of administrative things like that. It's just really hard for me anyway. So go get your kids here in a moment, right after this prayer. Go get them and bring them back in. Bring them back in, okay? But I want to just encourage you, just take a moment. And just you and Jesus right now, just for a moment, and just, I want you to listen to him, and I want to encourage you, because he's good, to just in your own heart say, Lord, whatever alignment you need to bring to my life, I say yes, because I trust you, and because I want to be a part of what you're doing in the earth. So, like David said in Psalm 139, search me and know me, God. Show me if there's anything in my heart that needs alignment. And I'm telling you, when you do that, he's good to lead you in that, and he's going to lead you into greater levels of freedom. So we just thank you, Jesus. We say yes to the alignment that you're bringing to the body right now. Like what Micah saw, you are the body builder. You want us to be strong. You want us to be ready. You want us to be prepared for what is coming and what you're doing in the earth. And you're not asking us to perform. You're not asking us to jump through hoops. You're just asking for our yes. You just want our yes. Jesus, we love you. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love you so much that we would say yes to you, maybe having to deal with things in our lives that could be painful, but we trust you. Because we love you. We love you, Jesus. You always heal. You always restore. You always make whole. You make all things new. Wow, I'm telling you guys, he is in the room. He's here in a very intimate way. Just put your hand on your own heart. Just say, yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Love you, Lord. Love you, Jesus. Wow, I see him just... He's giving kisses. Some of you are about to get wrecked by his love right now. I mean, just, he's gonna just wreck you with his love right now. See him walking around, kissing people on the forehead. Wow. Yeah. Do it, Lord. Do it. Do it, Jesus. Everything that's in your heart, do it. Everything that's in your heart, do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. Do it. There's people, now I don't want you to raise your hand because this is a very sensitive thing, but there's people here, you were raised in an abusive home and it's hard for you to see a good father who wants the best for you sometimes. Like the Lord has healed parts of that, but still, you have a difficult time sometimes seeing Daddy God as a good papa. And I just see right now, I see trauma, any residue of trauma from being raised in an abusive home lifting off of people right now. And if that's you, I just want you to just receive. Just say, Lord, I receive that. I receive that. You're loved and you belong. You're in a family. You're in the best family. So we just declare just any residue of trauma from abuse, whether it's verbal abuse or physical abuse, the Lord right now is lifting that off of people and healing your heart and healing, restoring your emotions, your soul. So right now, we just thank you. We just release that healing into the room right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord.
I have a word for Richard over here, the worship leader. You know, there's a lot of worship leaders. There's a lot of people that lead worship. But there, I honestly haven't seen very many that walk in a minstrel anointing. And what I mean by that is like this gift, this ability where David literally played the harp and spontaneously in song, there was deliverance. There was freedom. And I felt like, man, when you were leading worship tonight, I saw this minstrel thing literally like resounding out of you like a trumpet. Just literally freedom, freedom, freedom. Just even with the strum. And it comes from that secret place like David, where literally David was living from the heart of the Father. Where at the end of the day, it didn't matter what the people said after the stage.
but what the Father said in the secret place. And I just felt like the Lord, the Father was affirming you. Like, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you. Because I feel like that's a call. Like, sometimes I feel that. Like, where the Lord's like, where are the minstrels? Where's the minstrel anointing? And he's like, there's one. There's one. Everybody extend your hand to Richard. God, I just thank you. We thank you for your son. We thank you that this is your beloved son in whom you're really, 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 really well pleased. Not because of what he does, but because of who he is. But God, I'm declaring, I'm speaking it forth. I'm declaring it forth right now over your life. That minstrel anointing increasing. Breakthrough, God. Breakthrough, breakthrough, breakthrough. As he pours his heart out. Stephen and I saw this picture while you were leading worship. It was like you were slinging your heart all over the room. You were just flinging your heart all over the room. And God releases breakthrough. Breakthrough, 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 breakthrough. Signs, wonders, and miracles through your worship. Deliverance from demonic spirits through your worship. I see literally people coming in this place, and just through your songs, through your songs, your breakthrough, your songs, people literally getting set free from demonic spirits. Set free from demonic spirits through the atmosphere of the minstrel anointing, the atmosphere of this of his presence. And it could come with one word, one fresh word, rhema word, fresh word from heaven that suddenly hits the heart, hits the spirit of somebody in the room. So I just thank you for that, God. I thank you for that grace on his life.
Ma'am, and all the way in the back, right there. Yeah, you right there. What's your name? Linda. The Lord's touching you right now. I was just looking around the room, and I was like, I'm looking for the dancing hand of God. Where the Lord is touching you right now. You may not know it, but he's touching. Could you just put your hands out? Just close your eyes, put your hands out. Yeah, Lord, thank you, Jesus. Whoa. We just thank you for what you're doing there, Lord. He wants you to know how much he loves you. You came here for something, and he's saying, I'm here. I'm here. I see you. I hear you. I know you. You're not overlooked. He loves you. I just keep hearing him say that. I see you. I hear you. I know you. I hear you. I see you. I know you. And the Lord, I see him just releasing his love into your heart, and I actually see your heart expanding in your capacity to love others. You already do love people, but I see the Lord releasing his love into your heart in greater levels starting tonight, and your heart is literally going to expand in he's expanding your capacity to love the people around you, because you're going to realize and you're going to be convinced and it's going to be settled in you of how loved you are by the Father. So we just thank you for that, Lord. We just release that. We come into agreement with that in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. He's healing something. Is there something physical going on where you need healing in your body? Your family. Somebody with a heart condition? Or is it, what is it? Oh, okay. Something in the mind or the brain. Okay, can we just get a couple of the intercessors or the healing team, the healing rooms team, to go, and I want you to go ask her, go ahead and give them the name of your family member. I want you guys to spend a few minutes just really going after breakthrough.
Come on.
I really feel this word for anybody watching live, but also I feel like it applies for people in the room here as well. I just had this strong sense that there were specifically some individuals that were watching on live that were actually have been struggling out of nowhere, I feel like, since the turn of the year with just constant nagging thoughts of suicide. Like this thought that you can't shake it, and you're almost, you feel like you want to crawl out of your skin. I see you, I feel like there's actually one individual, you're sitting on your couch, and you've almost been just like weighed down, like you almost haven't even been able to leave the couch because you're so plagued by these pressuring thoughts. And it's tormenting, and I wanted to tell you, but I'm also speaking to somebody in the room. I feel like there's some individuals in the room, maybe you've been out of nowhere battling these nagging thoughts of suicide, and I wanted to tell you that it's not you, it's a demonic spirit, and we're going to command that demonic spirit to lift off of your life, to lift off of your life. Yeah, honestly, if that's something, if you're in this room and that's something that you've been battling with, I want you to come up and respond right now. It's not to shame you. We love you, and Father loves you. He wants to set you free. He wants to set you free. And I want you to come forward boldly. We're going to pray for you. We're going to break this thing off of you. For me, I was tormented with suicidal thoughts. I was tormented with depression, with all these different things. And when Jesus walked in the room, He set me free. He set me free. If that's you, I just want you to come forward right now. I'm going to give one more call. I just feel to give this opportunity. I feel like there's somebody here in the room. I'm going to pray for the person watching, but I feel like there's somebody here in the room that maybe you've been battling these thoughts. Come on. I'm proud of you. Come on. Freedom, freedom, freedom. In Jesus' name, thank you, Father. Right now. For you, those of you watching, freedom in Jesus' name. Freedom in Jesus' name. For you that are watching, right now, I just take authority over that demonic spirit of suicide. That demonic spirit, and we take authority in the name of Jesus, and we command it to lift off of your life. Those lying voices, those lying thoughts, be silenced. You have a purpose. You have a destiny. You were created in the image and likeness of God. If you're alive, if you're breathing, you have a purpose. You have a calling on your life. You have a destiny on your life. You're alive for a reason. You're alive for a reason. We take authority and we break it off your life. We're declaring resurrection power into you in Jesus' name. Freedom in Jesus' name. Freedom in Jesus' name. Freedom in Jesus' name. Come on. Come on. Come on. Yeah, I feel like there's, for some reason, lung stuff was coming to my mind. We're gonna go after some healing. I'm gonna call it some other words of knowledge. We're just gonna flow here. But if there's lung problems, there's something with lung problems. I don't know what that is. Is that you? Yeah, just come. Your husband? Okay, come on. What's your husband's name? Wes. Is that you as well? Come on up. Anybody come up with lung problems? I feel like there's somebody here that you've been having, you have a slip disc or something in a nerve in your back that literally out of nowhere almost cripples you where you fall to your knees. God's healing your back.
Micah's going to call out some words of knowledge, and then all of you just come up front. And then after that, if you came here believing God for a specific breakthrough and healing, we're going to have you all come up, and Micah and I will just lay hands on everybody. We're going to need some catchers because there's going to be some Ramba Shamba.
I feel like I see a picture of somebody that you fell and you slammed on your knee. One of your knees, I don't know which one it is, but you fell and you landed on your knee, and I feel like maybe you even shattered something in your knee. Is that anybody here? Is that somebody? Just come forward. Your brother-in-law? Wow, come on. We're going to pray for him right here, and he's going to come on. Yeah, even people watching, if this is applying to you, the things that we're calling out and you're watching, just respond. We want to hear what's happening because God is healing you right now in Jesus' name. I felt like people that have fibromyalgia, I don't know if there's somebody here that has fibromyalgia in your body. Just is that, come on. Anybody else, just come forward. Come on. Yeah, come forward. I feel like carpal tunnel is coming to my mind. There's something, there's just this massive, is that you as well? Come on. Come on. If there's metal in your body, any form of metal, I feel like there's somebody here that was in an accident about 15 to around 20, actually 20 years ago. You were in a major accident. Something happened in your body and you've had to have maybe multiple surgeries. Is that somebody here? Anybody here? You had, I think, three surgeries. Three surgeries, maybe having to do with your spine from an accident that happened. If that's somebody watching live, man, just comment. Tell us what's happening. If that's somebody that applies to you, God is releasing healing, not even through the prayer, but through the word of knowledge. God, just Jesus just called you out himself. He just walked into your room, and he's saying, I am healing you in Jesus' name. Come on. Come on. Come on. I feel like somebody here, you damaged one of your shoulders. Something ripped in your shoulder. Something damaged it. Maybe your rotator cuff. Something got jacked up in your shoulder. Is that you guys? Is there anybody out here? Just come forward. Come on. Come on. Come on. Somebody broke their ankle. I feel like when you were a child, something happened. It was like maybe a terrible sprain or a break, and something damaged in your ankle, and you've had fluid or something build up or cartilage, something wrong in your ankle. Is that anybody here? Is that anybody here? Just come forward. Is that you? Come on, your son. Just come forward. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on.
There's just an anointing right now for people watching live. I just felt it so strong that the Lord, he's coming into your room and releasing healing right now. I just encourage you to check your body where you need healing. This is for people here too. The Lord is releasing healing. We just release the anointing of God to just come in and just break off spirits of infirmity off of people right now. Go in Jesus' name. And we just release healing right now. Be healed. All things made new in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord.
There's somebody here that you've battled panic attacks, or maybe it's something actually with your heart, but it's like these anxiety panic attacks, but it actually is something physically wrong with you. There's something maybe off when it's something that you've battled. Is that anybody here? Just come forward. God's going to heal those attacks and heal that thing on your life. I feel like it has to do with some sort of rhythm or thing in your heart and actually a physical thing. Come on. Yeah, awesome. Come on. Come on. There's somebody here that I feel like you've had chronic migraines for 10 years after something that happened. It might have even been whiplash. You had whiplash. I don't feel like it was from a car accident. It was from just something really unusual, and it's something that just caused your neck to whip, and since that point you've had migraines. Is that anybody here? Is that you? Come on. Jesus is healing you. Come on. Come on, somebody here has tennis elbow. Tennis elbow, there's some, you hyper, actually not tennis elbow, you hyperextended your elbow, and also somebody that hyperextended their knee. I feel like you were running and just, you know, you popped it in too far. There's somebody here with that, elbow, knee. Just come forward, come forward, come forward, come forward.
Thank you, Lord. Now everybody who's up, everybody who's at home, and who's up front here to receive healing, put your hands out. We're going to lay hands on you, but I want you to just respond to Jesus. Now listen, who paid for your healing? Jesus did. By his stripes, you were healed. Okay, so just say, Lord, thank you. Thank you that you purchased my healing. And I receive it by faith. I step into it by faith. Thank you for healing. Thank you for freedom, for breakthrough. Micah, did you have any more words before we lay hands on them? Okay. Did you feel like you need to release it? Okay.
This isn't a healing word. We're going to stay in this, but I felt like I needed to release this word. Is there anybody here named Bill? Anybody here named Bill? Bill. Where? Bill. Does heart trouble mean anything to you? Heart trouble or anything like that? Okay, the other thing that I heard was December 23rd. Does that mean anything to you? That's all right. I'm learning to hear God's voice. Here's the prophetic word that I felt for you, Bill. Would you just stand up? I heard the words breakthrough. Breakthrough, breakthrough, breakthrough. God is declaring breakthrough over your life. Things are coming into alignment. This is the year of answered prayer. This is the year of answered prayer. This is the day. This is the time. This is the year for unfinished business to be completed. Unfinished business. And I see family coming home. I see family coming home. I feel like there's, I don't know if it's a son or something, a family member. There's somebody, a child that's coming home. Does that make sense to you? Wow, they're coming home. This is the year. This is the day. Answered prayer. Family's coming home. Family's coming home. Come on. I feel like there's actually particularly one that was that's a prodigal that knows. And I feel like some of the family has said, they should know better. They should know better. They should know better. And they've constantly said that over that person. And they're coming home. They're coming home. I see the father just embracing the prodigals. Embracing the prodigals. So right now we just speak to Bill's family and we just call that family home. We call the family home. I thank you that this is the year of breakthrough over Bill's life, over Bill's family. The year of breakthrough. Breakthrough, breakthrough, breakthrough. Breakthrough. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Come on. Amen. Amen.
While these guys minister to people that are here, let's just worship the Lord. We're just going to be ministering. And also, if you need any kind of healing as well, you can come and specifically you came for a need and he's like, I want breakthrough, I need healing. You can come and we would love to pray for you as well. If we get the lights turned off, so as we minister, but we just want to release you. Tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, come. Right here, bring people who need healing, bring people who need ministry. But we're going to continue to worship and we're going to pray for people here and minister to people. So thank you guys. Have a wonderful night. God is moving. God is ministering. God is setting people free right now. In Jesus' name.